السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيًا عن قومه ورسولًا عن أمته. اللهم ارزقنا حبه وحب من يحبه، واحشرنا مع من يحبه يوم نلقاه في الجنة بإذن الله. Brothers and sisters, this is the day of Eid al-Adha. Eid al-Adha, for those who do not know, is meant to mark the greatest of sacrifices humanity has ever known, the greatest form of submission and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know that in the Quran itself, both the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the believers are both told to the Prophet, Allah says, فَاتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Follow the millah, the faith, the belief, the way of life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Hanifa means someone who is only tilting towards what is right. And the Arabs used to call the Al-Hunafa, a group of them who lived on the Millah of Ibrahim up until close to the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To the believers, Allah says, فَاتَّبِعُوا مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Again, follow the Millah, the faith, the way of life of Prophet Ibrahim. Where do we know the Millah of Prophet Ibrahim from other than the Quran and his life? So we know from the life of the Prophet, Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, which is also named the father of prophets. His descendants constituted all the prophets that came after him were from his descendants. This is a promise that Ibrahim wanted to protect his son Ismail, and Allah responded and said, Ismail, I will bless. Also, Allah blessed his other son, Isaac, who was born 14 years after. 14 years after Ibrahim was born, Ismail, Isaac was born. At that time, Ibrahim was 100 years of age. Imagine a frail, very old man, 100 years of age, being given a child. But at 86, he begot Ismail. That also is not an easy fit. But it is the work of Allah. It's not the work or the effort of Ibrahim. So this man, Ibrahim, is the one, through his own descendants, Allah sent all the prophets. It was all one Israelite after another, prophets after prophets, from Isaac, Jacob, Yusuf, Moses, David, Solomon, all of them throughout up until Isa alayhi salam. And after that, the message place shifted. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told the children of Israel, on the tongue of Isa himself, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and it will be given to a nation that produces the fruits of it. And here is an issue that I want to digress upon a little bit. We are supposed to be the nation that produces the fruits of the message of all the prophets. Our nation, the Muslim Ummah, should be the nation that doesn't only carry the message to others, but it should produce fruits that even if you don't speak about Islam, people know what Islam is through your behavior. So are we the fruits of the message of the Prophet? Are we producing the fruits of the message of the Prophet? Do we know what the fruits are of being a follower of the Prophet? One of the fruits, do not start by you being a witness against others. It starts by you being a role model of what a decent, courteous, respectful, and merciful human being is. Summarized in the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you but as a mercy to the world. Our message of mercy and the word rahmah, translated into mercy in English, captures all what is good about being a human being. All what's good. And this mercy is not limited to other humans or humans of your own faith or to your family or just your neighbors. The alameen includes the world of humans, the world of jinn, the world of the environment in which you live. Every living and non-living thing is entrusted into the hands of humans to be only used according to the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know the story that a woman was sent to hellfire because she caged a cat. Neither did she feed it, nor did she let her go free to fend for herself. Can you imagine? A woman is sent to hellfire for killing a cat by caging it. And a man was forgiven all his sins for caring for a thirsty dog in the desert. The man was walking in the desert. He was thirsty, very thirsty, about to die, and he found a well. He went down the well and he drank as much water as he could, or he should, or he needs, and he came out to find a thirsty dog panting and panting and panting. And I said, this dog is as thirsty as I was. He took off his shoes, went down back to the well, and got the dog water from the well. The hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, Allah forgave him all his sins. So the mercy of Allah should never be limited to myself or my family or people I love or people who believe as I do. It is to cover every creature I come across. The Prophet ﷺ tells us, even if you are making your ablution from a running stream or river, do not waste water. That's a care for the environment. Don't waste water, let alone don't pollute water. Do not throw chemicals in water. Do not prevent others from reaching water. Water is the source of life for everybody. So we share it and we keep it and we grow it as much as we can and we use it wisely. Muslims should be on the cutting edge of turning those principles into working plans and realities. We need to make plans to make sure that our neighbors know Islam through us. Islam is not just about prayer. It's not just about sacrificing an animal. It is not just about feeding the poor. It is way beyond that, to create an environment that is Muslim, an environment that submits to God. an environment where people love to submit and learn to submit through us. So Allah sent the Quran to the entire humanity, telling them, look back at Abraham and see what he stood for, what he did, how did he translate the principle of submitting to God into a way of life. You see, Ibrahim alayhi salam was married to Sarah, but she did not bring him children up until he reached 100 years. So by the age of 80 something, she said, Ibrahim, we may die without leaving a child. Why don't you go ahead, marry your maiden woman, talking about Hajar, that he picked from Egypt on his way back to Palestine. Marry her, and maybe Allah will give you a child. And Ibrahim married Hajar and asked Allah to give him a child. Ibrahim, subhanallah, is one of those prophets you don't see him asking Allah for things. His major dua, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاء رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ. Or his other dua or prayer supplication that he and his son Ismail made when they were raising the walls of the Kaaba. As he said, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. O Allah, accept from us. إنك أنت السميع العليم ربنا وجعلنا مسلمين لك. O Allah, make us both Muslims, submitting to you and to you alone. ومن ذريتنا أمة مسلمة لك. And from our descendants, make an ummah that lives the case, the principle, and the attitude of submission to you. So he's praying for us before we were born. Before he had seen a child, he wants descendants that submit to him, to Allah, as he and his immediate son Ismail submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How did Ibrahim translate submission into action? Allah, after Ibrahim was given a child at 86 years of age, very old, very frail, very weak, Allah tells him, take your son Ismail and your wife Hajar, that young wife that you have, take both of them and settle them in Mecca. It's a tall order. Mecca was not a town. Mecca definitely was not a city. It was an arid desert valley. Very dry, no water, no life, no cultivation, no plants. Who in his right mind would go from the green land of Palestine to the arid desert of Mecca at that time? But Ibrahim, his submission to Allah was greater than his fears. His trust of Allah was greater than his concerns about his wife and his son, baby son, carried through the desert to be delivered at the end to live in the desert. Just in the age of infancy, breastfed from his mom, that was his source. So when he delivers his wife and her son to the desert, to Allah, and left them in the desert, and he was walking away, she, being his student, she runs after him and she says, Ibrahim, whom are you leaving us for? And he says, nothing. Ibrahim, whom are you leaving us for? He didn't even look back. He did what Allah told him. So he delivered them to Allah in the desert, not knowing anything but his faith in Allah is that they will be safe. They will be okay. Not only him, By the third time, she asked him the same question, whom are you leaving us for? And he didn't answer. Then she said, did Allah command you to do that? The question tells you how much faithful she is, how much faith she had, both in Allah and in her husband as a messenger and a prophet. So she asks him, did he tell you to do this? And this is the only time he turns back and he says, yes, one word. She goes back to Ismail, the infant that she left on the floor, and she said, إِذَنْ لَنْ يُضَيِّعَنَا. Then Allah will never let us down. It's an amazing, abiding faith in her heart. Where did she pick it from? She did not pick it from Pharaoh in Egypt. She picked it from her husband, Ibrahim. And she breastfed this faith to her son, Ismail, to become the father of the last prophet, or the great-great-grandfather of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He begets Ishmael at the age of 86. Ishmael begets 12 children, and those children, one of them is called Qidar, becomes the oldest grandfather of the Prophet before Ishmael. Then it doesn't stop there. Yes, Ibrahim submitted. Hajar becomes thirsty. The milk is drying in her breast. She doesn't have more water. Water is gone. Dates are gone. She needed something. So she haste walks between the mountains of As-Safa and Al-Marwa, as Muslims do this today and yesterday and tomorrow and every day, to seek water. By the seventh round of going between the two hills, she doesn't get water where she was, but few meters away, Ismail kicks the ground with his heels, crying, and the well of Zamzam gushes out. From there until today, the water of Zamzam is still coming out. I'm saying this to show that we need to translate our faith in Allah into following His command. Follow the model of Ibrahim. Ibrahim, Allah told him, invite your people to Islam. They were idol worshippers, including his father. Some say his uncle. It's not a big deal of difference. So he tells his dad, and his dad threatens him, if you don't quit what you're saying, I will kill you. I will stone you to death. Ibrahim doesn't stop because he has a message to deliver. How does he talk to his father? It's a lesson we need to learn. The kind Ibrahim, the merciful Ibrahim, the loving Ibrahim, the compassionate Ibrahim, it teaches every child, and I urge everyone, read those ayat in Surah Maryam. Surah number 19 in the Quran, very beautiful dialogue. Ibrahim is being threatened by his father. Ibrahim is praying for his father. Very compassionate, very respectful, very loving. And the words he used to call his father is, Ya Abati, oh my dad. Amazing language and level of civility and respect. Of course, that's his father. But Ibrahim then was faced by the community. You are going to destroy the community and our faith. Those idols are your gods as they are ours. Ibrahim determines in himself, I'm going to destroy all of them. You take them as gods, let them help you. I will show you they cannot help themselves. So he destroys the idols, and soon, as far as they discover, they brought him in. And they set the fire. Ibrahim doesn't run away. They capture him, put him in a ditch, and they set the fire around him. He doesn't run away. He knows that he is delivered. And what's more amazing, he doesn't ask Allah for anything. Look at this level of abiding trust and faith. I will be delivered no matter what they do. Nobody's gonna harm you unless Allah allows it to happen. That is his faith. And this is what the Quran summarizes for us. وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍّ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ. So Allah, seeing and knowing what is going on, he orders the fire to be merciful and cool for Ibrahim. Amazing. Then that does not stop there. He goes back from Palestine to Mecca to revisit his son. His son became a young man, and Allah tells him in his dream to slay his son. Another test. Again, Ibrahim submits. Not only by himself. Ismail, the young man, submits. Where does he learn it from? His dad was away, but his mother taught him what Islam is about. These are lessons we must learn, we must practice, we must tell our children what is the role model. The role model is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Isa, Musa, Dawood, and all the rest until his great-grandfather Ismail and his own father Ibrahim. These are the models we should bring back to reality. Not the movie stars, not the sports stars, not the technology gurus, not the inventors of this or that. These are role models in their fields. But the role model for humanity are the prophets and their raised children that they have raised, and they accepted the message and submitted to Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us follow on the model of Prophet Ibrahim. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina istafa. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وبعد. Brothers and sisters, if we train our wives to be like Hajar and train our children to be like Ishmael, definitely our ummah will lead the world. But this is not the objective, political leadership. The objective is the moral leadership. We have a lot of politicians who are leading the world wherever they go. But we need one thing, the moral leaders for the future. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us train our wives to be like Hajar and train our children to be like Ismail. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اهدنا لأحسن الأخلاق فإنه لا يهدي لأحسنها إلا أنت. اللهم باعد بيننا وبين الشرك. اللهم باعد بيننا وبين النفاق والرياء وسوء الأخلاق. اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا ومن عذاب الآخرة. اللهم لا تجعل للشيطان على بيوتنا سبيلا، ولا تجعل للشيطان على قلوبنا سبيلا، ولا تجعل للشيطان على أهلنا وذرياتنا سبيلا. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. بارك الله لكم عيدكم، صلوا أرحامكم وأحسنوا إلى أولادكم وأهليكم. بارك الله لكم في عيدكم، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Please, we are late. Please exit quickly.